Hi, I'm James Schillinglaw, and I'm here with Amy Berquist, who is the Vice President, Conservation, Education, and Sustainability for Lindblad Expeditions. Now, Lindblad just announced a wonderful program called the Galapagos Island Relief Fund, and we're going to talk to Amy about that program in particular and what it means and what it's going to do, and it all is an obviously reaction to the horrible crisis we've had over the past year with COVID-19. And you're going to find out about all that and more on Insider Travel Report. Now, first of all, Amy, how are you and where are you?
Hi, James, and thanks for having me today. Great to be in your program. I'm coming to you today from a cold and sunny Virginia, and I'm happy to be able to talk with you and the Travel Observer community about a place I love and a place that so many travelers around the world care about.
Well, I'm looking forward. I still have not gotten there, but hopefully soon when we're allowed to go, and it'll be great. Now, let's get to that big news. You know, you just launched this new Galapagos Island Relief Fund in partnership with a group called Island Conservation. Talk a little bit about this program, how it will work, and how it, you know, it will seek to counter the impact of COVID-19 on tourism to the islands.
Sure, yes, this is big news indeed. We are so happy to begin getting the word out, especially to the advisor community that have played such a critical role in getting travelers to Galapagos over the years. So the Galapagos Island Relief Fund, it is a campaign of hope. And Lindblad Expeditions is launching this together with Island Conservation and a local nonprofit group in Galapagos called Funcavid. And its aim is to re-energize the Galapagos economy, which, as you said, has been incredibly hard hit as a result of the loss of tourism. And it will make microloans available to the people of Galapagos for students, small business owners, entrepreneurs, farmers, artisans, to really give them immediate financial relief. And one of the things that really energizes me about the project is it's done in conjunction with a local nonprofit. It's led by people who are living and breathing this crisis every day and really know where the need is existing and how we can have the biggest impact possible.
No, that's great. And now, what is Island Conservation and why did Lindblad Expeditions partner with this group on this project?
Yeah, Island Conservation is a nonprofit organization. They care about island communities, and their main mission is to remove invasive species from island communities around the world in conjunction with local partners, government agencies, and conservation organizations.
Right.
So they're headquartered in California, but they do have a local office there in Galapagos. And our decision to work with them, there's a practical reason, which is they are a 501c3 charity. So anybody who's interested in donating to this relief fund can do so and get the tax advantage that would come along with that, or the tax deduction.
Right.
And the other reason is that Island Conservation, like us, they realize that conservation of a place like the Galapagos can only happen when there's a stable community in good shape. And right now the people of Galapagos are in crisis. And yeah, so we're hoping that by working together, we can stabilize the economy, stabilize the community, and then get back to the really important work of conserving this special place.
But this sounds like a little bit different tack for them, where before they would be trying to avoid invasive species, and now you want to inject funds, which
That's
is
right.
a little bit different both for both of you, I guess. Now, you did talk a little bit about the impact on the loss of tourism. I've heard that as much it represents as much as 80% of the island's economy in the Galapagos. Is that true? Is that that's the impact? It's a lot, right?
Yes. I mean, what we're hearing is, I mean, in a word, it's been devastating. More than 80% of the local economy depends on tourism. And before I get to the question about, you know, why this matters, I thought it might be helpful for the audience just to talk briefly about Galapagos.
Okay.
Everybody knows it's this group of islands, but four of the islands are inhabited. Most people are familiar with Santa Cruz. That's where the Charles Darwin Research Station is located. That's the largest island. And then San Cristobal is the next largest. That's where the provincial capital of Galapagos is. And then there's two very small communities of people on Floriana and on Isabella.
Right.
But overall, the population is about 30,000 people.
Wow. I always think of it being these remote islands that all you have is a few turtles and all these wonderful species, but not that there are actually human beings on the islands, right?
Yes. Well, and that's one of one thing we're excited about with this campaign is people do. They think about the tortoises and the blue-footed boobies, the flightless cormorants. But right now, we really want to focus on these people.
Right.
So approximately 30,000. And locally in Galapagos, there is an emergency committee formed that did a survey of these residents about 2 months after the pandemic started. And at that time, 8 out of 10 business owners had no income whatsoever. The local reports were that 1 out of 2 families would not be able to pay for their just daily needs for 30 days after the survey was finished. And 3 out of 4, 75% of people were not getting the perishables they needed for food, fruits and vegetables and that sort of thing. So the need is dire and the need is urgent, because those numbers were coming out back in, you know, May, June, and here we are 6 months later.
No, absolutely. Well, and I think I read in your release that for even in the first few months, 2 months of the crisis alone, there was estimated loss of about $50 million in tourism, and as well as almost, you know, they've lost 95% of all tourists, right?
Mm-hmm. That's right. The ongoing economic impact right now is about $20 million a month.
Right.
And according to the Galapagos National Park, the arrivals into Galapagos are down 75% in 2020 over 2019.
I'm actually surprised that anybody's going on there.
I know. Yes. It's, I mean, Galapagos, they were able to establish a safe corridor for travel back in August. Right. So, you know, tourism has been at a trickle, I would say, since August. And they are open for business, but it's just a question of when people are really going to be feeling comfortable to go back and
go back. Yeah. Of course, I think the ironic part about this is we always talk about sustainability and over tourism and trying to protect the Galapagos by limiting cruises and tours and most of the time. And here we are, they're hurting because they don't have the tourists. Is there a fine line here between, you know, too much and too little, right?
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, over tourism and tourism that is not well managed is a problem in many parts of the world. But under tourism, which really is a new concept that's been coming out of this pandemic, this might provide even a greater threat, especially to conservation. It's a threat to the livelihoods of the people who depend on tourism. But as I mentioned earlier, I mean, conservation can take a really big hit when there aren't tourists coming who care about the place. And this latter part, the threat to conservation, this is what Lindblad Expeditions cares so deeply about. I'm not sure if our advisors will know this, but back in the late 60s, in 1967, Lars Erik Lindblad was the first person to bring travelers to Galapagos. And at that time, if you were not a scientist, the only way to get to Galapagos to see it was to go with the Lindblad family. And he paid the salaries of the first 2 national park rangers. He worked with them to establish a lot of the rules and guidelines that are still in place today to responsibly manage tourism. And so, you know, our hope, and this is something we've been committed to for so long that we talk about, is that getting travel back and continuing this notion of conservation being baked into our DNA will be able to continue the conservation of these islands long into the future.
No, so obviously Lindblad has a history here, and as you said, it was the first to bring tourists there. So now you want to keep the tourists coming, but in manageable portions, I guess, right?
Exactly, yes.
Now, let's talk a little bit about where is this money coming from for the relief fund? I know it's not from Lindblad alone, but talk about, you know, obviously you're looking for donations from even travel advisors, their clients, past travelers. And then I believe you're going to have matching funds from Lindblad as well, right?
Yeah. So the way we've set it up, anyone, anywhere in the world may donate to support the Galapagos Island Relief Fund. Lindblad Expeditions initially shared it with our travelers, with people who have been to Galapagos themselves and developed that personal connection. And we also shared the news out with our advisors and our affinity and charter partners and other strategic partners we work with across the business. One of our expedition leaders always says that to know Galapagos is to love it forever. And right. So we thought the best place to start was with the people who really, really know Galapagos. But the word is now starting to get out through the media, through social media, the press, and we will welcome donations from anybody in the world who wants to support the people of the Galapagos.
And then you are matching some of these funds as well, right? Lindblad itself.
Yeah, so Sven Lindblad worked to set up an initial match. He and his wife have a fund called the Wanderlust Fund.
Okay.
So they will match. The Lindblad Expeditions Board of Directors will match, and then Lindblad Expeditions as a company will match. So that's 3 matching dollars for every $1 donated up to the first $50,000.
Okay, and I think your goal is to raise about $500,000, right?
Right, yeah. When the idea first came to us from Funcavid, that local nonprofit I mentioned, who's going to be working on this locally, their goal was 500,000. And, you know, one thing I think is really important to point out about this 500,000 is that it's not that the money will come in and be spent and then it's gone. What they're trying to do is create a circular economy. These are microloans, first microloans. So people will use them to do whatever they need to do, whether it's education or farming or businesses or entrepreneurial ideas. And then the loans will be returned and they can be used again by someone else. So hopefully this will develop a sustainable new way of having an income in Galapagos and create income streams that don't rely on tourism so much.
No, that would be a great hope of going forward. Now, how is this money going to be distributed in the Galapagos? What kind of projects are you targeting in terms of, you know, helping out schools, communities, local businesses?
Yeah, well, this is another part that I'm really excited about. There's a lot of different categories that will be eligible for the funding. So it will be distributed as small microloans. So they could range from $500 up to $5,000, nothing greater than $5,000. And projects will include education, small business reactivation, entrepreneurial development, so new ideas, basic needs, and that's just to name a few. Some of the recipients, they may do things like participate in trainings to start their own urban gardens. Maybe other folks interested in farming need some funds to bring in an irrigation system. For students who are trying to continue school from home, they might need devices to do so. And another thing in Galapagos that is a pretty big challenge is getting connected to the internet. It's expensive. Oh, wow. And it's not always reliable. So some of the money could also pay just for the very basic thing of being connected to the internet. Other ideas, you know, there's a lot of local artisans in Galapagos. They might be able to do some training to learn how to bring their products for sale online, or other producers that are making other things, you know, coffee producers, jams and jellies, I mean, all sorts of things.
Sure.
So the possibilities are numerous. And I think, you know, it's just important to remember that whoever receives each one of these loans, might be businessmen and women, might be students, farmers, artisans, or a family. But whoever it is that receives it, hopefully with the practical money, they'll do what they want to do. But it also will bring back a sense of hope.
Yes.
Because that sense of hope is what is missing. We got together with about 30 of our naturalist guides last week, and there's just this sense right now that a lot of people, they see their dreams disintegrating before their lives.
Yeah.
One of our naturalists, her parents had built a hostel, and you know, they haven't been able to welcome guests now for 9 months. And it's these individual people, these individual stories that even the smallest donations will go to make a difference.
No, absolutely, and I totally understand. Now, what are the programs that is Lindblad currently offering Galapagos programs, or have you paused like other expedition cruise companies?
Yeah, so unfortunately, we have had to pause. We have two ships that are based full-time in the islands year-round, and we last had travelers aboard in March. Since then, we've been keeping in regular touch with local and international authorities around health and safety and all those protocols. And we'll continue to follow the news very carefully. But right now, both ships have completed their annual maintenance, which they usually do at this time of the year. They are crewed. They are ready to be reactivated as soon as it's safe to do so.
So you don't have any estimate or hope when you will start cruising again?
Well, we have hopes. It's as soon as possible.
We can't
predict the future, but we are hoping that we can do so as early as possible in 2021.
Now, is there a COVID issue in the Galapagos? Have people gotten COVID there, to your knowledge?
There were some cases, but it was very well managed. I think one of the benefits of being a remote island chain 600 miles off the coast of Ecuador is that the local authorities hopped right in at the beginning, and it was very well managed.
That's great. That's great. Yeah. Now, so you have the cruises. On deck for 21, you do have some programs that you're hoping to launch. Are they mostly cruises, or are they combination cruise land?
I would say it's mostly cruises, but we do have extensions that people can purchase. So our two regular kind of the bread and butter programs aboard the two ships are 10-day and 7-day options. The 10-day option is longer. It's aboard the National Geographic Endeavour 2, which is the newest ship in the fleet.
Oh, wow.
And then the 7-day option is aboard the National Geographic Islander. And that's a smaller ship. It's a catamaran style. But both of them offer the same level of interpretation from naturalists, a chance to learn about the undersea world, a chance to learn about photography, family program where kids can work to develop the mindset of an explorer. It's a program we developed with National Geographic Education. And I think for advisors, you know, which one to recommend, it sort of depends on the flexibility of the client. If people are limited for time, they can go on the shorter trip. They spend 4 full days on the islands and then some travel time. If they go on the longer option, they're spending a full 7 days and they have a chance to visit as many unique islands as possible.
Well, it's kind of a bucket list trip that, obviously you have some people coming back, but it is kind of that trip that you want to probably spend some time in the islands as much as possible while you're there.
Absolutely. Yeah. And for those who they want to spend some time in the islands, but then they do want to explore further on land, we have a Peru extension. And then some clients even decide to add Amazon onto the experience. So it's all back to back to back while they're in that part of the world. And one new offering for 2021 I wanted to point out is we have a new photo exclusive Ecuadorian Amazon program. Oh. And details about that are on our website at expeditions.com. But yeah, we're trying to bring a few new things for 2021.
Yeah, hopefully you can get out of the box and get going on those trips. That's right, as we all do. I know that I was actually planning to go to the Galapagos this coming year too. So it was definitely going to be something that I wanted to try out finally. Would love to try your product as well, but we have to make sure that everything starts to get back, right? That's the first.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I know for a lot of people, Galapagos is a bucket list destination. And we've been reading articles about, you know, this concept of revenge travel, where people are really just wanting to get out there and get to all these bucket list places. So, you know, we're hopeful that Galapagos will see a good recovery to tourism.
Absolutely. Now, it is remote, and you know, it's a place that, you know, everybody says that the trips that are going to come back soon are going to be the ones that are kind of to far off places with lots of space and lots of nature. So hopefully this is going to be an appealing one. Now, how can travel advisors and their clients get involved with the Galapagos Island Relief Fund? What can they do?
You know, there's a few different ways to get involved. I think the most obvious one is to donate, which would be great. But we realize that this has been a really tough year for so many people. So we also would love any ability to share the campaign through networks on social sites and also sharing stories. You know, so many of the advisors in your network have been to Galapagos or they've sent clients to Galapagos. And stories, I think, are really powerful to bring a place to life and to really convey what the magic is about them and why they're so special to protect. And Sven Lindblad always says that it is the passion of the travelers that will save the special places on Earth. And there's no better way to share the passion of a travel adventure than through a story. So if the advisor community could do that, I mean, that would just be absolutely wonderful.
Well, I've met a lot of, I haven't been myself, but I've met a lot of travelers and travel advisors who have been to the Galapagos, and clearly there's been an expansion of travel products into that area, and it's high demand. It is definitely one of those, great trips of the world that everyone feels you should take. It's like Antarctica or anything like that. This is in that league, especially for expedition cruising. So this is really, you know, it's something on everybody's bucket list for expedition.
Yeah, there's no other place like it in the world.
Absolutely. Now, where can travel advisors go to learn more about the Relief Fund?
So the main campaign page is islandrelief.fund. And that's a campaign page. It's hosted by Island Conservation's website. That would be the place to go to donate. To get more information, Lindblad Expeditions also has a wonderful travel advisor page on Facebook. And, you know, a lot of the advisors are already part of that, but we would love to welcome some new faces on there to learn both about what we offer, but also about this campaign, because there's plenty of information about the campaign on that site as well.
Wonderful. Now, any other messages you want to get out to our travel advisor audience about the new, COVID relief program, the Galapagos relief program, and what they can do?
You know, I think I do want to say thank you to the travel advisor community. I was speaking with our sales team earlier today, and they just had such this expression of, you know, we are all getting through this time together. And we really appreciate the support, the partnership that the travel advisor community has shown to us. And we are just extremely hopeful that together we can support this community in Galapagos. We want to get back out and traveling. We want to be able to continue the important conservation work that we do. And travel advisors play a key role in getting travelers to Galapagos to help us with that work. But before we can get back to that, we have to take care of the people who are there and the people who call this place home.
Yeah, no, any thought about doing this same kind of campaign for other places that you visit, because clearly COVID has had such a devastating impact on the tourism of so many different countries in third world countries. And, you know, and it's going to be tough for them to get back. We all always focus on the infection rates and the deaths. We haven't really focused as much on the damage that this has done to tourism economies in the entire world. But it sounds like this kind of relief fund could be something that could be applied elsewhere, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely something we talked about. We decided to start in Galapagos because that is our largest presence. We have two ships there that are year-round. But if it goes well, if we see that there's an appetite from our travelers to continue doing this kind of work, which I'm sure there will be, we are always open to doing whatever we can to protect the places we go. And, you know, I've been thinking recently, you know, people are focused so much on the travelers aren't able to get out there and see the world. But in this kind of a situation, I kind of think the world is wanting to see the traveler, because the traveler is the one who cares about it, learns about it, and then ultimately makes a difference.
Well, Amy, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak to us about this really, you know, incredible fund, Galapagos Island Relief Fund, that Lindblad Expeditions and its partners have started. It really is so crucial at this time, as you pointed out. And again, it's that battle between over-tourism and under-tourism that we're facing here. You know, you and I a year ago would have been talking about over-tourism. And now we have really under tourism in so many different places in the world, including such iconic destinations as Galapagos. So congratulations on starting this fund. Let's hope that you can get some people to donate. So go out and donate some money if you're a travel advisor, or talk to your clients who have been to the Galapagos or who may want to go someday. You know, let's help these people out.
Yes, thank you so much, James, and thanks for having me. And I really, really appreciate the work of the travel advisors, and I look forward to seeing what we can all do together to protect and care for this wonderful, wonderful part of the world.
I'm James Schillinglaw, and this is Insider Travel Report.